Okay, so today I'm talking to Phil Benson in Tokyo, Japan. This is at the JELP National Conference, and Phil's just given a plenary about learner autonomy. Thank you very much for giving some of your time.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you. So, first of all, I'd just like you to tell us a little bit about how you started in teaching and where you are now and how you got there, very briefly.
Well, how I started in teaching was, I guess it was an alternative to unemployment, to graduate unemployment in the 70s. I have a sociology degree and graduated in 77. It was pretty high unemployment at that time. And I went to do a PGCE, a postgraduate teaching qualification in England, for which you could be get an extra year's grant at that time. And I ended up in Algeria. That was West Midlands College, and I ended up in Algeria as a school teacher. So I did 4 or 5 jobs in different countries: Algeria, Kuwait, Seychelles, Malaysia, and then Japan.
And then you went to...
Then I ended up in Hong Kong, yeah. Hong Kong. I've been there for the last 20 years.
So tell us about the context that you're working in now. What kind of school is it, and what kind of thing are you doing?
It's a teacher education college. It's the Hong Kong Institute of Education. So it's mostly devoted to teacher education. It's expanding a bit at the moment, but the main context is courses, undergraduate and postgraduate courses for teachers, English teachers. So I'm in the English department there.
Okay. So you gave us a kind of nice, concise definition of what autonomy is. Could you expand on that? What is autonomy?
The ability, capacity to control your own learning is the definition that I like.
Yes, yeah.
And I like the word control. I think control is, other people have used words like take charge of or take responsibility for. And I like the word control because it's direct. Mm-hmm. It's less ambiguous than taking responsibility for something, which can kind of mean you take the blame. And also you've got a lot of connections with control. You have connections with the use of that term control in other areas of literature, especially psychology. So a useful connection for me.
Yeah, I wanted to come to the psychological a little bit later, actually. Because I've been reading the second edition of your book, Teaching and Researching Autonomy, came out earlier this year.
Yeah.
One of the things I was reading in there, which you also referred to in your plenary, was that the number of publications on autonomy has increased quite considerably. And the interest in autonomy, I think the number you said, in the preceding 30 years, from around 1970 to 2000, the amount from 2000 to 2010 was kind of double.
Right.
The amount of publications and papers and books that were published. Why do you think that's so?
Two reasons. One is that the interest has grown, so you have a lot of conferences, and every conference tends to produce a new book, and a lot of new people have got involved in that. But I think the other, the one that's more difficult to explain is that there's just a lot more social interest in ideas of autonomy, individuality. I mean, this sort of the social and the individual is the big debate in a lot of areas of social theory at the moment. I guess it's quite a pervasive sense, at least in Western societies, of people lacking control in their lives, needing to take more control of their lives. There's a lot of theory which kind of says, well, that's right, you don't have much control over your life, and that's how it should be. And there's another body of theory which I'm interested in, which is really saying that people do have more control, I think.
Autonomy, probably could say that it grew out of the 1960s kind of European context, a kind of social and political idea. But, of course, that context has changed, and now the idea of autonomy has spread and changed and altered. but you still think it's relevant today?
Well, I think it's more relevant today, yeah. I mean, if you look around, I mean, there are, for example, you have debates in the States over abortion, rights of the child, and so on. Now, autonomy is very central to those kinds of discussions. You know, is it the autonomy of the unborn child, or is it the autonomy of the potential mother? You know, whose autonomy is most valued? And these things are, there are sort of philosophical debates over that, similarly about what's like a mercy killing or euthanasia. Again, autonomy has sort of come into those debates. So I think, it comes out, I mean, the origin is in the 60s, but I think particularly in the 90s and the last 10 years or so, there's been much wider discussion, particularly of philosophy, in a philosophical sense.
Okay. Your subtitle, I suppose, of the plenary was about how to do autonomy to do here. Yeah. And the here is in inverted commas. So, and the here is
anywhere, wherever
you are. Because as you mentioned, a kind of for people who don't necessarily understand the idea or like the idea of autonomy, they say, yeah, that's all very well, but it wouldn't work here.
Yeah.
So you gave some, especially at the end of your plenary, you gave some nice ideas of how any teacher can do something to implement or to foster autonomy in their own context.
And mostly already are doing something, you know. I mean, there's a list of 10 sort of ideas, things that you can do that foster autonomy. And when I've done this elsewhere, you know, I've seen people nodding, say, yeah, well, yeah, actually, I do that already. That's something I do. So I think it's, they're things you can do without, they're not too risky. They don't cause too much disruption, but, you know, they're good for students.
You talked about the kind of degrees of autonomy, perhaps, and the different dimensions of learning. In which, and again, to come back to the control that you talked about, perhaps some people misunderstand autonomy as a complete lack of control or a loss of control, but that's not necessarily the case, right?
Okay, so I think in general, as teachers, we believe if we're not controlling things,
yes.
Not deciding what students will do, there will be no control. Okay, and in many ways that's true. If you simply sort of, you know, if you simply give up, if you simply say, okay, you do things for yourselves from now on, you know, perhaps for 90% of the students that will be the result. There'll be no control. So the problem really is to try to. I mean, fostering autonomy really is about teachers helping students to have more control. But in order to do that, they also have to give up the control, quite a lot of the control themselves. So it's a kind of delicate balance.
Do you think students, in most contexts, if they're given the opportunity, will exercise their autonomy successfully?
Well, that's difficult to say because, I mean, there are a lot of contexts where students are learning foreign languages and they really don't want to do that. So, in a sense, you know, if you take a bigger picture of autonomy, to me it ought to, you know, people shouldn't necessarily be learning when they don't want to learn, and they shouldn't necessarily be learning subjects that they don't really want to learn. And I mean, I think we know that from sort of adult education and so on. That, you know, there are different times in your life when it's good to learn and times when it's not good to learn. And so on. So if you take that bigger picture point of view, yes, I would say that if you let people control their own learning, they will learn. But they may not do it exactly when you expect them to, and they may not learn what you expect them to.
Well, and I suppose part of the reason they don't want to learn is because they've had such negative experiences trying to learn previous of education in the first place. So if you allow them some self-agency, then they may, in time, come to capture that desire. That was the word you used, rather than motivation. Right? You said desire. You mentioned teacher autonomy, and I suppose I see teacher autonomy, you could say it has two strands, really, in a way. One is that teachers need to have some autonomy in their decisions that they make, and there are pressures from institutions or parents or governments and so on which remove that teacher autonomy. But also, I suppose the other thing is teachers have to be to become autonomous in the way they learn to teach, rather than expecting to be trained.
Yes.
So what do you think teachers should be doing to become autonomous themselves? Autonomous teachers.
Well, I work in a teacher education institute, and I would put a lot of responsibility on the shoulders of teacher education institutes, which tend to be conservative. I mean, in a sense, school education is pretty conservative, and then teacher education is often, you know, the sort of conservative sector of the whole education system. So I think really it starts there, and it involves teacher educators giving the students experiences of autonomous learning themselves. And this is the crucial thing for me, is that it's not, you know, I can stand and give my students a lecture on how they should be more autonomous, but by doing that, they're just listening to me.
Yeah.
I'm not encouraging them to be autonomous, so they, you know, there'd be a lot of contradictions in what I'm doing.
So the cycle just continues.
So I think there's a lot of responsibility there for teacher education to try to, you know, to align everything that's happening. I know where I work, for example, we will go and supervise students who are doing teaching practice, and we'll kind of criticize them for not teaching in a kind of, well, more learner-centered way, when they're actually doing exactly the same things that we're doing in our own classes with them when they're the students. So so I think that experience is really the important thing. They have those experiences.
So teacher educators need to lead by example, by kind of allowing their trainee teachers to become autonomous that way. One of the biggest changes, I think, which should have an effect on learner autonomy over the last few years would be the increase of technology and the opportunities that that affords us.
Yeah.
But it doesn't always necessarily do so. You just end up with programs where students are drilling something, or sometimes, you know, I think learner management systems end up being more about administration than learning.
Right.
What do you think about technology in education? What do you think is good practice, perhaps, to foster autonomy?
Well, at the risk of annoying people who are involved in CALL, I think that to some extent CALL is kind of trapped in a way of thinking that actually goes back to the days when the potential for using technology was pretty limited.
Yes.
So, you know, you have those programs where basically students are drilling. Well, that goes back to the 70s, and that was pretty much all you could do. That was the best thing you could do with a computer, and it was really good at that time. But I think to some extent that it's a kind of mentality that you're trying to create software, self-contained software, where you'll have a student, computer, the software, and the software is doing as much as it can to sort of teach the student. But on the other hand, I think there's massive potential in social media, in things like YouTube, in the possibility. I mean, most students now are actually very actively, most EFL students, I think, are already actively engaging with English on the internet. I've been involved in studies where we've sort of really looked into what students are doing, and it's usually pretty surprising to the teachers. You know, they say that they don't use English outside class, but in fact they are. The internet is the main locus where they are actually engaging with English, and often, you know, they've got friends overseas and so on. So I think that's where the potential is. But if you want to exploit that potential, I think you've got to move away from the idea that, you know, we're making software, we're making programs that will help to teach learners. And it's more something I think it goes over to teachers. It's more of a social thing, it's more of a pedagogical thing, it's not so technological anymore.
One thing which some teachers might fear about autonomy is they feel that if students become truly autonomous and they realise that autonomy, then the teachers themselves may become redundant. How would you calm those teachers' fears, or is that a relevant fear?
I think autonomous students are pretty demanding. It's not that they... It's not that they don't want teachers, it's they don't need teachers. I mean, it's that they will make use of teachers. They will, and that itself can be threatening. Autonomous students can be quite difficult students to deal with, you know, because they expect a lot from you, and they often come up with sort of unexpected things and so on. So if you're teaching in that way, you've got to be a lot more flexible, a lot more prepared for the unexpected. But I think it's wrong to think that we're going in a direction where we don't need teachers anymore. No, I think teachers are... I mean, in most situations like self-access or with call as well, generally the argument has been that you need more teaching input. Although it's not necessarily in the form of face-to-face teaching in the classroom.
Well, I suppose, mentioning self-access centres, I suppose the most successful of those are the ones which are, it doesn't matter how many computers or books or resources you have in there, if they're not staffed, then they probably will not be successful.
Absolutely, yeah.
I guess it's more...
There's no doubt about that. Yeah. The most successful ones have got good staffing levels, yeah.
So it's not so much that the teachers will become redundant, it's just that they need to change their roles.
Change what they do, yeah. Okay. Change our way of thinking what teaching is, really. No,
it was 12:30. Well, I think that's a good note to end on. Thank you very much.
Thanks.
Thank you.